you know, at the core of this this study group is an examination of a new model of governance in the democratic framework that is emerging in Eastern Europe, and particularly in Hungary, to some extent in Poland, and using as its model the authoritarian regimes, one of them semi-democratic in Turkey, and then, of course, further to the east, a governance project that is hardly democratic but has some elements of that in Russia. So this model is what we're going to examine. And I come to this as a practitioner as well as something of an academic on it, because I've spent the last 7 years as the president of Central European University in Budapest. And so I've seen the laboratory out of which this new model has been growing, and it's grown over 7 years, so we'll examine it and see what it looks like. But that's not our only topic. We will then compare this with, to some extent, developments in Western Europe, and some of them are going on literally as we speak, including the French presidential campaign and the upcoming elections in Germany, which will have a big impact on whether the model from the East that we'll examine is going to move further to the West. And then, of course, we will also examine the question of whether this might be happening here, whether this model has any resonance in the United States, and what that resonance might be, and what the differences might be, and what the areas of resistance might be in the terms of the model. So that's the overview. Let me state what I think are four core questions that I'd like really to get your views about as we move forward. First is a somewhat theoretical question, but I think it's a really important one for us because it involves, particularly for those of us who are Americans, examining something that we've sort of taken for granted. It's sort of like breathing. And it's the difference between the two principal current models of democracy. One is the one I've been describing briefly, the illiberal majoritarian model, which involves an election, to be sure, but then after that, various things that happen to the second model, which is the one we've taken for granted, and that is the liberal pluralist model. And what are the differences between those two models? What happens in a liberal pluralist democracy that doesn't happen in an illiberal majoritarian democracy? I think this is a crucial question, because if we're going to examine how to see whether the traditional model of democracy that we take for granted, like breathing, in America is going to survive, we've got to understand what it is that we're trying to preserve and why it's worth preserving, and what are the elements of liberal governance. So that's the first big question. And to some extent, that will be the focus of today's session. Then the second big question is really a kind of fact-finding question, and here Amanda and I can produce the facts for you, and that is what's actually happening to democracy in Eastern Europe, in particular in Hungary, but also in Poland, and what does the new model, which is illiberal majoritarian, look like? How does it function? What is its impact? What's its reception? How do people relate to it? So we'll look at that, and that's really the topic that is in Amanda's research paper, and it, of course, is also covered in the longer article that I circulated that I published earlier in December. So that's the second question. The third big question, and here we really begin to get into the Europe-U.S. situation, comparison. What are citizens demanding today? What are people demanding of their democracy or their governance, for that matter? What do they want? And I think there are all sorts of questions and ideas that are out there, but the research that we've examined is pretty sketchy as to what it might be. There's certainly the demand for participation. I think this is rather global in nature. I think it's certainly in China, for example, participation. People want to have some engagement in the decisions that are being made about their lives in their communities, or even certainly in a broader and a broader context. So participation demand is definitely there. Then there's the identity demand. I want the government to recognize me. I've been left out for a long time, and nobody's paying attention to me. And I think the Trump voters in the United States are particularly in that category. And there's a very fine book that I want to recommend to all of you that delves into this. It's easily readable. It's a book called Strangers in Their Own Land by Arlie Hochschild. That's Hochschild. We'll circulate the identity of the name, you know, later with the materials. But this really looks at this question of identity politics and the identity demand that, that we see. Now, the identity demand also exists in Eastern Europe. You've left us out for a long time. We want you to pay attention to us. You in Brussels are sort of a distant governing body of the European Union, and here we are in a small city like Kolozsvár, where your grandparents came from, in the Transylvanian section of Romania, and you're paying no attention to us. So that sort of identity demand. Then there's the question of improved governance. Do people want improved governance? Do they actually want a government that works well for them? Do they want the snow to be cleared properly? And do they want other kinds of services to be delivered to them? And if so, how? And then the final question, which I think is very much on the table, particularly after the Trump election, is, are they looking for institutional revolution? Do they want a fundamental change of the institutions that we have in our society that relate to democracy? So those are some of the demand possibilities, and I'd love to get your thoughts about what they might be and what you think. We're examining all of this, and there's a paper that has been circulated which begins to get into this. Then the fourth big question, and the one that I expect to kind of use to wrap up the book, if it becomes a book, is the basic question of whether is liberal democracy, that is the liberal pluralist model, is it resilient? Does it have a life in today's world? Can it survive? What are the ways in which it might survive? Might it just muddle through? Let's assume we have a very, whatever, sort of normal set of circumstances over the next 4 years under President Donald Trump. We might muddle through. But what about the danger of an emergency, like terrorist attack or war or any of the other emergencies which have traditionally been the sources of tremendous power accumulation by illiberal governance regimes? And what about the differences between Europe and the United States on this? So that these are not exactly small questions, but they're important questions, and I hope we can really delve into them. So today, February 16th, we will look at this illiberal governance model in Eastern Europe and the difference between liberal and illiberal democracy. March 7th is our second study group, and we will then look at the democracy demand and identity politics set of issues that I mentioned. And then two sessions, April 13th and May 4th, all of them are at 4 to 5:30, I believe. This one is a little later because we had to get the room. Those two sessions will be on the core elements of liberal democracy that are under attack by illiberal democracy. They are freedom of the media, independence of the judiciary, and independent civil society and civil liberties that go along with independent civil society. Those are the sort of core issues that we'll examine then. And then finally, the last session, we will really look at the question of resilience and survivability, long-term sustainability of liberal democracy in a very rapidly changing environment. So, you know, we could adjust ourselves as we go along. We could decide we want to go down this path and we don't want to go down that path, and I invite you to do that. This is very, it's supposed to be very interactive. So now a quick overview of this illiberal governance model that we're going to make the focus of today. Well, let me stop for a moment. Does anybody have a question or a comment about what I've just said before we go into any more detail? And by the way, I've asked everybody to introduce themselves as they come in. Could you just say a word about who you are and your background?
Sure. My name is Alex Langerman. I'm at the business school across the river. My background is in infrastructure development and construction, particularly in the Middle East and Saudi Arabia.
Great. Thank you.
And I'm Trisha Flores. I joined HBS HKS.
Okay.
I did energy before. From Romania. That's why I'm interested in.
Romania. Oh, I want to get to you in a minute. There's something very powerful happening in Romania, even today, and you're going to be our expert on it. Good. Okay. I'm going to be whetting everybody's appetite. And in fact, it goes to the issue of resilience of democracy in a way. So thank you. Okay. Any other questions or comments that anybody has? Okay. So when I came back last fall from Hungary after being president of Central European University for 7 years, some of my friends accused me of having an illegal import coming into the United States. What do you think it was? It was illiberal governance, you know. They thought I was responsible for this because I'd been living under it for 7 years, and here it comes in the form of the presidential election and some of the things that started happening in the early days of the Trump administration. So, but I say that with some, hopefully, sense of humor, but just as an indication that that's my credential for delving into this, that I know it well because I've lived with it, and I've had to run a university in an illiberal environment and a university committed to academic freedom and debate and discussion, which survived actually during the time that I was there, and it survived and flourished. So anyway, there's that. So, you know, what we have now across Europe is the rise of a kind of nationalist populism in Hungary and Poland. We've seen it in Brexit in the UK. We certainly see it in France and the Le Pen campaign, the Netherlands with Geert Wilders, and in Italy, the resistance to the EU, even in Austria, where there was a very close election result in the fall, the far-right candidate did not win. But at the core of all of these developments is an assertion, and it was made probably most originally by Viktor Orban, the Prime Minister of Hungary, and it's an assertion that an election is the authority and all the authority that's needed for majority control of all the institutions of government and civil liberties and elements of society that are taken rather for granted in a liberal democracy, that's still a democracy. It's an election, and an election produces the authority within a theory of democracy. Now, of course, all of the theoretical elements of pluralism are denied by that. But in a sense, for good reason. Because what someone like Orban and certainly Putin far further to the east and Erdogan have done is to look at the elements of liberal democracy and pluralism as standing in the way of their centralized authority, which is what they are seeking to do. And to some extent, there's even been a demand for that. For example, the protection of minorities, the independence of the judiciary, freedom of the media, pluralist civil society, civil liberties backed by law, these are all elements of pluralist democracy that stand in the way of someone who's trying to aggrandize and centralize power, which is really what's been happening. You know, this in some ways is a reflection of the response to the popular discontent with democracy that you certainly see in Hungary and elsewhere in Eastern Europe, and frankly in the United States and in various parts of elsewhere in Europe, discontent with the way democratic institutions are working, the way government is functioning, et cetera. And the roots of this discontent in Eastern Europe in particular are the global financial crisis of 2009, from which only the elites have fully recovered, and everyone else is basically still, many of them, particularly people living in rural environments, see themselves as even worse off now than they were in the communist era, to some extent. So there's a deep economic underpinning of this discontent with democracy. But in my estimation, the roots are deeper than that. And they can be found in four major political, social, and economic developments of the last 50 years, which have both strengthened and weakened democracy simultaneously. But we tend to think of them as having strengthened democracy. So I put them before you with a contrary view. And the first one is the civil rights revolution of the 1960s and 70s, which resulted in a tremendous development of new rights and recognition of rights, particularly African Americans in the United States, but minorities of all kinds, and women, and gender, and sexual minorities, and the rights revolution, which continues today, has been a tremendous asset for a democracy, but it's also been the source of counter-revolution by majorities who have felt left behind. And so the civil rights revolution has a kind of double-edged sword here. The second big revolution is the market revolution of the 1980s, which involved deregulation and the rise of globalization and a lot of flow of capital across borders, new economic elites being developed, and growing inequality. And I think the roots of the discontent with the market revolution can be found now, obviously, in the results of what's happened after the 2009 financial crisis, because people feel that they're left behind. And the growing concern about inequality, which in some ways comes about as a result of the market revolution, which looking at it as a positive, the market revolution has had a tremendous impact on development in many parts of the world. I would say in China in particular, the market revolution has produced an incredible development of opportunities for literally a billion Chinese. And so we shouldn't in any way look at this as just a negative. It's actually been a positive, but it's again been a double-edged sword. The third revolution, more specifically related to Eastern Europe, is the political revolution of 1989. And there again, the fall of the Berlin Wall and the triumph of democracy and market economics and the collapse of the old totalitarian regimes, all of those looked like very, very positive developments, and indeed they were. But they also resulted in a loss of social support, particularly in Eastern Europe, so that in the end, there are many people who have felt left behind, particularly by that revolution of 89, because their circumstances, economic in particular, have not improved significantly since 89. And then the final revolution is the digital revolution of the 1990s, which, of course, as we all know, increased tremendously information and communications, but also led to the rise of social media echo chambers and fake news and surveillance, all of which have had a corrosive effect on liberal democracy, as well as a positive effect in terms of the digital world, essentially providing more avenues for communication and more opportunities to get information. So after all these revolutions, democracy in the West, and including in Eastern Europe above all, has been in pretty deep trouble. There's been a distrust of elected leaders. This is all before Trump and before Orban, of course. They were more responsive to this. An alienation from distant decision makers, particularly in the EU, attacks on minorities, growing corruption, and political polarization and gridlock. So out of all of these, or in a sense a reflection of all of these developments, is that Eastern Europe has become a laboratory for this new governance model. Now, what is this new governance model? First of all, it's fallen on fairly fertile soil in terms of its appeal, because this Eastern Europe, as I said, was very hard hit by the financial crisis. It's had little, unlike the United States or Western Europe, it's had little or no experience with democracy. There really hasn't been much democracy in Eastern Europe until after 89. And a long history of outside oppression from the Ottomans and from the Russians and the Germans and the fascists and the communists. I mean, they were, you know, if you lived in Eastern Europe, you really felt that you were under a lot of pressure from the outside world. Civil society in Eastern Europe was shattered by totalitarianism, so that there wasn't the kind of vibrant civil society that we now associate with, particularly here in the United States. And all of this created a sort of tinderbox for the rise of populist authoritarianism, and the tinder was really struck by Viktor Orban, who is now the prime minister and has been for the last 7 years of Hungary, using a narrative that's going to sound quite familiar to us who followed the narrative of the rise of illiberal politics here in America. The narrative of victimization by distant elites, the politics of fear, terrorist attacks are being linked to refugees, and this has resulted in increasing racism and xenophobia, a great amount of Islamophobia in Eastern Europe, which doesn't really really in Hungary and in Poland in particular, but also in Slovakia and the Czech Republic. There's a lot of resistance to the refugee populations that are coming in. So this resulted, this matrix, in the election of Viktor Orban in 2009, really before some of these developments that I've mentioned, the security developments in particular, but still very much on the soil of we're a little fed up with how badly we're doing economically and couldn't we have better governance, and we need more recognition, we Hungarians, and nobody's paying attention to us in the European Union. So the entry point for his new model was an election in which he depicted the opposition as elitist and cosmopolitan, and appealed to the insecurities and the need for strong governance. He won a two-thirds majority in the parliament, which was critical to what he then achieved after that, which was to fundamentally rewrite the constitution of the country, to initiate intensive regulation of the media, of the courts, of civil society, so that very little opposition out there beyond the center was possible after he got started. And he was quite popular in this regard because he had a promise of efficiency. He said, believe it or not, let's make Hungary great again. So I think we've heard that slogan elsewhere. And by the way, it's interesting that the first foreign leader to call Donald Trump and congratulate him on his election was Viktor Orban. And Viktor Orban from this small country in Eastern Europe is going to be given a state visit in the United States. I think the date has been set at sometime in May. So, you know, the slogans are being exchanged by these leaders. I think the symbol of his appeal to insecurity is and here again, there's some resonance, razor wire fence that he has constructed on the borders of Hungary to keep out refugees. But it's not just the security issues that he's appealed to people on. It's also their fear of cultural amalgamation. He's appealed to religious and ethnic homogeneity, that we are a Christian nation, and we don't welcome people who are not Christian. There's sort of borderline on anti-Semitism. There's a long history of anti-Semitism, of course, in Hungary. So the rejection of liberal cultural norms, secularism, civil rights advances that have challenged traditional organizations of society, particularly gay rights and Roma rights. The Roma are the minority in Hungary, a very small minority, but, well, large in comparison with other European countries, but deeply discriminated against. All of this has been very hard on them. So that's the bad news. Now, let me give you some of the good news. I mean, in my estimation, I think this model that I've been describing has fundamental weaknesses, and they're already beginning to show. And this is where we're going to bring in Romania in just a minute. The economy is certainly a weakness. It's hard to run a centralized, semi-authoritarian governance model and develop and deliver prosperity when there are few natural resources and it's a relatively small country. And I think Hungary's sluggish economy tends to show that today. So that's one overall weakness. But the biggest weakness of all is corruption. And corruption, I think, is the Achilles heel of illiberal governance. And what happens in these regimes, and it certainly happened in Hungary, is that it tends to breed oligarchies that come together. It's very much happened in Turkey, and it obviously we know what it looks like in Russia. And the oligarchies divide up the resources and in many ways leave the citizens behind in that regard. So this can lead to a big popular backlash. So the question now is looking at this model of illiberal governance that we've seen, its vulnerabilities, particularly the one that we've just identified with corruption. Now looking at this in a comparative context, can this happen here? What's the prospect of illiberal governance in this model developing in the United States and essentially eliminating the various elements of pluralism that we consider to be important? We should talk about why we think they're important. So I think the answer is yes and no. It's not a real answer. I think that this is a different political history in the United States and a different political culture. There are certainly eerie parallels in the very early days that we've seen here in the Trump administration of the immigration ban, the attacks on the courts, the attacks on the media, denigration of minorities and women, denigration of political opponents, assault on the facts and truth, and all of that that we know very well. And above all, the appeal to fear and insecurity. The most disturbing thing that I've heard coming out of the White House recently is after the courts have exercised their constitutional authority to review the president's executive order, the president said, if there's a terrorist attack, Americans should blame the courts. And, you know, this is a chance to really denigrate one of the core elements of American democracy. So it's very disturbing. But the big question is how resilient is you know, American liberal democracy? And I think just two quick points about that. First of all, we have a history of resisting and overturning even illiberal actions by American presidents, reigning in presidential abuses of power. We've done this over the last 75 years, and there are four examples that I would cite, just to be bipartisan about it. The first is President Roosevelt, who was probably one of the most famous Democratic presidents, of course. His notorious effort to change the whole structure of the Supreme Court of the United States by naming four justices and pushing through a Democratic Congress legislation that would change the number of justices in the court was known as the court packing scheme. And it was resisted. It was resisted across the board, even in the Congress, among the Democrats. It was seen to be a power grab that was inappropriate, and the various elements of American democracy basically came back, and Roosevelt withdrew his court packing scheme. Second is Richard Nixon and the abuses of the intelligence agencies that go under the general heading of Watergate. I was very involved in that as a young civil rights lawyer. I was involved in cases that of people whose phones had been wiretapped by the White House illegally, and we won those cases, and that information, along with other information, went to the House Judiciary Committee in the Congress, and they voted articles of impeachment of Richard Nixon, and he had to leave office. The third example is Ronald Reagan, who I think otherwise had a pretty strong record on civil rights, but he allowed, and some of his associates promoted, an attack on the federal courts to remove their jurisdiction over cases for where remedies of busing in cases of school desegregation or the issue of school prayer, which was being adjudicated in the federal courts. They wanted to take that jurisdiction away. And certain aspects of abortion litigation would have been taken away. So it was a real attack on the independence of in some respects, of the federal judiciary. And that was turned back. It was turned back in the Congress. It was turned back by a wonderful coalition that I was involved with. It involved Republicans and Democrats, the American Bar Association, the American Civil Liberties Union, very much active in that. So American civil society, bipartisan way, pushed back on that. And the final one, and I hesitate to say anything about this with the world's expert on it sitting next to me, when President George W. Bush and his associates began to use torture in violation of U.S. and international law, there was an institutional pushback within the Pentagon, led in many respects by Alberto Mora, so you should all know in whose company you sit. And, you know, there were a lot of others in American society who pushed back on this, and eventually the torture ban was reinstated. So thank you, Alberto. And he's teaching about it and writing about it today, so if you could say more about it, obviously. So, you know, we've had experience pushing back presidents' abuses of power. We also have institutions that you can rely on, I think, in many respects, the federal courts, which have been very active, as I've just said, in the immigration issue, and they are independent, and these are judges appointed by presidents of all stripes, going all the way back to President Reagan, Sir President Bush. In fact, there are more Republican appointees who've been involved overturning some of these immigration issues than there have been Democratic appointees. So that's interesting. And we also have the federal system of government, which, unlike Europe, which is a much more centralized system, is decentralized. Only in Germany is there a constitution that has a federal system similar to the United States. And that means that there are centers of government power outside of Washington at the state level and even the local level, and experiments and variations in democratic practice can occur across the system, and the system can push back, at least in theory. So we have that, and then we do have the Congress, which right now, of course, is dominated by the Republicans, and just as Viktor Orban was able to dominate the parliament in Hungary, but it's not a two-thirds majority, and the systems that we have in Congress, including the filibuster and the cloture rules and a lot of technical issues related to how the U.S. Congress operates, make it difficult for a majority to impose its will in many important cases involving the U.S. Constitution on the minority. So there are areas of resistance there. So that's a kind of an overview of how resilient, what potential resilience there might be in the United States to what's going on. So.